Yeah, I was gonna say Peter from Brand for Kia. Hey everybody, it's Peter from the Kia Hyundai channel. Welcome to our live video series. Today we're taking a look at the 2022 Hyundai Santa Fe Preferred with the Trend Package. And we're doing that because you guys suggested it, you guys asked for it, and that's what we're gonna put on our video today. So if you've never seen our videos before, we're gonna go pretty in depth here, but we're gonna wait for our live audience to join. So if you're watching with us and you're not live, you can skip ahead to the 3 minute mark of the video. That'll be where we start with the content. In the meantime, we're gonna talk about some news and some notes, some good questions already asked that I'll answer as well. And let's go through and show you how to join us live if you'd like. Anyway, Peter, any eyes on the Ford Maverick? Yeah, it looks like a cool vehicle. Love to have one in here compared to a Santa Cruz. I think that'd be cool. All right, you guys forget that I like all kinds of cars, not just Kias and Hyundais, but I like to talk about Kias and Hyundais. All right, here we go. Kia Hyundai channel, if you go there at 2 o'clock, go to our YouTube page exactly at 2 o'clock, you can see we have a video up here, whatever that video, it could change at times, but if you refresh the page at exactly 2 o'clock, you're gonna see us have the live video right there. So every day, 2 o'clock Eastern time, the live video will be right there. We're gonna click into that. You have to watch an ad. I have to run an ad. If you are shopping in Ontario for a new vehicle, connect with me. You can reach out to me through the link that will be in the description as soon as this video is posted, and I will connect you with our team at Brantford Hyundai, Owen Sound Hyundai, or Brantford Kia. All three of those dealers are dealers that support this channel. Do me a favor, support them as well. And there's your ad. I'm great at running ads, I think, right? I think I should run more ads. All right, so what's going on? Somebody just asked Sorento pricing. Any insight on Sorento PHEV pricing? Insight would be a perfect word for that. I don't have actual pricing, but this video today can give us insight onto the Sorento PHEV pricing because this vehicle is also available as a PHEV and a hybrid. So we'll talk about that a little bit later. What else are we gonna talk about? Tomorrow, big day tomorrow. We finally got another Kia Carnival SX in. That is an absolutely mind-blowing car. Even if you're not into minivans, you should probably watch that because that is gonna go on. So he says, when are we painting the rest of the wall? That wall there, we are gonna put a Kia logo with a Brantford Kia Studios sign up top. So we'll do that as soon as somebody other than me gets it done. It's not my job. I do other things around here. So that's coming as well. But yeah, tomorrow, Kia Carnival, SX, lounge seats. We're gonna talk about that in ways that other people haven't talked about in the past. And a lot of people are ordering that car. So it might be something worth watching to see what's really in depth in there. And frankly, I just like it. It's the nicest car we have. It's nicer than our Telluride, hands down. And I'll hold to that. I think Telluride's really nice, but I think the Carnival's nicer, the SX anyways. So we're talking about that tomorrow. What else are we doing? Today, Ioniq 5 stuff, rumors in the States that it's pushed back. I haven't asked for Canadian push, if there's dates have been pushed back, so we'll find out some of those things in the coming future, coming time soon. Meanwhile, we're basically at that 3 minute mark now, so we're gonna get going here. All right, everybody, thanks for tuning in. My name is Peter, I'm from the Kia Hyundai channel, and today we are taking a look at the 2022 Santa Fe Preferred Trend Package. And like I said, we're doing this because you guys have asked. Really quickly, let's just show you where we are in the model lineup because it gets a little bit confusing in here. All right, so Santa Fe, this is Canadian pricing, we film in Canada. Essential is right there. The Preferred is the next package up. It is the higher trim level with still the non-turbo engine. You'll notice available as a plug-in hybrid or a hybrid. We'll talk about that in just a second. And pricing is, where we go, $36,499. This one has the Trend Package, so we're gonna select this for a second, and you're gonna see some insight. Somebody asked earlier in the video, do we have any insight on the Sorento PHEV pricing? Well, there you go. This is the Santa Fe pricing for the hybrid. You're gonna add $2,900. For the PHEV, you're gonna add $8,500, but let's just put that in perspective really quickly. You're about $3,000 more for a hybrid. In Canada, you have a $2,500 government rebate. So that takes that $8,500 to $6,500 more than the base model, which is only about $3,500 more than the hybrid. So in Canada, practically in the Santa Fe, about $3,000 more for the hybrid, about $3,500 more than that for the plug-in hybrid, which is a pretty good value given the government rebates and stuff. So there's that. This car has neither hybrid nor plug-in hybrid, but it does have the Trend Package, which I highly recommend. If you hit learn more here, panoramic sunroof, leather seating surface, LED taillights, 8-way power front starter seat, folding second seats, and the LED lights, that kind of thing. So really quickly, let's go back to here so I can see things when I need to. If I was gonna build, people always ask me, what would I buy? What would I want? So if anybody ever asked me what I would want in an SUV, if they said family SUV, what would you get? Well, first of all, it's gotta have enough room for my family, check. I like having a roof rack, it's not a big deal, but it has that. All-wheel drive, of course, has that. Couple things I would really want. LED headlights, that's a must for me. This has that. Lane follow assist, this has that. Smart cruise control, this has that. Panoramic sunroof, this has that. So really, there's a Santa Fe for everyone. And I think what's interesting is this one really checks a lot of boxes for a reasonable price. The 2.5 liter non-turbo is a perfectly good engine for a lot of people. If you need to tow, it still tows 2,000 pounds, but maybe not as much towing capacity as some people want. But for a lot of people, this is really good. I happen to have it in a beautiful red color, and I already forgot the name of that color, so we'll have to look that up a little bit later. Over along the front, in a world where everybody's going black trim, black grills, black everything, this particular trim line has a nice, I don't know if it's chrome, but sort of metallic look to the grill. And I think it works well with this red paint, kind of offsets it nicely. So bold moves here. You got bold sweeping areas of metallic looking trim there. There's your smart cruise control, another radar sensor up front. You've got some nice hidden things. We'll show you lighting in a little bit later. Marker lights up top, headlights down lower. Nice job with the daytime running lights as well in this car. 18-inch alloy wheels, and again, just a really sharp-looking overall car, and they really do make a Santa Fe for everyone. I said that about the Sonata as well. They make a Sonata for everyone. They make a Santa Fe for everyone. So you can go more power, you can go more efficiency, you can go plug-in hybrid, regular hybrid. But this one, I think, is sort of that sweet spot that suits a lot of people. All right, real quickly, I'm going to grab the key so I can throw it in my pocket and never have to show it to you again. There is the key, simple Hyundai key right now. You'll notice that remote start on the key fob. While we're talking remote start, I'm 95% sure, better just double check. While we're talking remote start, yes, okay. While we're talking remote start, this does have the BlueLink system as well. You can use your cell phone, this is me holding my cell phone, and you can start the car from your cell phone, blink the lights, lock the doors, do all kinds of different things from your cell phone, including getting it ready in the winter, like starting it up, turning on like heated steering wheel, those kinds of things. So really like that BlueLink system. But again, if you don't want that, that eventually will be a subscription service. It's free for, I believe, 3 years right now. You can, if you don't want that in the future, you still maintain the remote start on the key fob, which I think is important for a lot of people. So a single touch here would unlock just the driver's door. Double tap would unlock all the doors. Inside here, there's that power seat we talked about, part of that trend package, leather seats, part of that trend package. Nice perforations as the detail in these seats as well. And you also have this, a little bit hard to show, but a little bit of a detail to this piping here, silver type piping. Overall, a very high-end style interior. One of the things that stands out to me is, of course, this is on all the Santa Fe's, this sort of speaker grill detent kind of thing. And the color's flame red, thank you. So the speaker grill detent right here looks pretty cool. On the higher calligraphy models, that sort of pattern blends into the seats. They put it up like in this area. I don't think you need that. This feels like a very, very nice SUV. I wouldn't call it a luxury one, but I certainly wouldn't call it anywhere near a base model type feeling. And again, it is sort of a mid-pack model. Coming inside here, one thing you're going to notice, things like the windshield. Always it's been laminated glass. This generation has a little bit thicker laminated glass. What does that mean? Better sound insulation. So you've got really good sound insulation. There's a whole bunch of nerdy details you can go into, from the carpeting to the dash and all those things that help keep this car quiet. Effectively, it works. It makes it nice and quiet. Now, one thing that can create some echoes is the sunroof up here. I don't mind that at all. It's a massive sunroof, as you can see, and big panel out front, which moves back, big panel out rear, and of course, you can also close an opaque panel across the top. And what I like here is, it's hard to show, maybe I could film it over here in the sunlight. Let me just try to flip around here. Ooh, come on, camera, there we go. The roof liner is kind of a unique material. It's a lighter gray color, and it's just a little bit different than some of the other cars. It has a little bit of an interesting look to it. And again, I know most of you are gonna hop in the car and never think much of it, but it's the little details that stick out that I always point out. Those are the things that go in your head like, oh, it feels nice in here. And sometimes you can't figure out why. Just a little bit of different fabric, a little bit of different feeling in around this car. That helps make it nicer as well. All right, let's turn the vehicle to on, start the dash up, and you're gonna see a nice little system check there. Of course, we are in the vehicle. We are inside, so we can't fully start the car. So you're going to see some warning lights on. That's what we do every day. You can see a nice color display screen in here. There's a lot of information in here. Auto stop, timers, all kinds of things. This is your fuel efficiency. That's a bar graph that moves back and forth. A little blue bar graph moves there. 10 liters per 100 kilometers. That's probably on the trip that I've done it, or since refueling, excuse me. So 10 liters per 100 kilometers, probably not fully accurate on this car. But again, been sitting around a dealership. Dealership cars always get a little bit worse mileage. A lot of settings you can change in here. Let me just make sure one thing. Lights, yeah, that's what I thought. Just wanted to make sure high beam assist and headlight delay. We'll talk about those in a second when we get to the lighting. And let's move across here. You can see your all-wheel drive bar graph. I love this bar graph. It's hard. I'm gonna have to do a driving video with this bar graph. It shows you when your wheels are active. And the big thing with this all-wheel drive system is it's not a slip and grip system, which is a terrible design that we used to just accept was a standard on crossovers for a long time. It used to be the front wheels had to lose traction before you'd send power to the rear wheels. And then you'd have to try to regain traction. And sometimes if your front wheels didn't gain traction, your rear wheels would have traction and just push you further off the road. Bad system. That's not what this system does. This system starts with always all four wheels active. As it senses traction, it'll move it back. Things like turning the steering wheel can send power to the back. All seamlessly, all, you know, imperceptibly to the driver. But what that does is it keeps the car really, really secure feeling, even in slippery conditions, snow, rain, other stuff like that. So really good all-wheel drive system. And you can see it working there, which I think is kind of a nice thing to have. Let me just slip across here. Lane keep, lane follow, driver attention warning. And again, back to here. One thing I just like is just the speedometer, keeping that up on the speedometer. You have a digital speedometer as well as, of course, the analog gauges on either side there. Coming across this screen here, Android Auto, Apple CarPlay, HD radio, really nice stereo system here. And because you have this 8-inch screen, the Android Auto and Apple CarPlay is wireless, which means you can just have your phone connect wirelessly, which is very nice to have. You know, basically that means you have navigation in this car as well through Google Maps, Apple Maps, or other competing systems like that. So very, very simple, very clear. While we're at it, can I show the backup camera? Yes, I can if I hit the button. There's the backup camera as well. And I think sometimes the grid lines are our parking rear guy. Oh yeah, of course. So they're not on because I didn't actually hit the grid lines. I didn't actually put the car in reverse. Normally you have grid lines, but if I put the car in reverse, you would see those. Because I actually just pressed this button here, you won't see the grid lines. It's a newer feature on some of these cars. You don't have to throw it in reverse to peek behind you. And just kind of a nice feature if you see your kids coming back to maybe put their backpacks in the trunk or something like that. You can keep an eye on them until they're there without having to throw the reverse lights on, which is kind of nice. So we're going to click that there and come down here. Now, some people say that this design of the dash is controversial. You have this massive space underneath here. Practically speaking, for me, I don't have a ton of use for that. That doesn't mean it's not a good idea. And I'll show you why I think it's a good idea. So again, there's that space there. If you are the type of person who carries a purse, that's a really good spot. If you take a tablet, you can put that tablet there, charge it through the 12 volt or USB plug in there. There's a lot of things you can use that for. Some people, frankly, use it as a garbage can for their coffee cups or their, you know, wrappers and stuff like that. I don't think that's my style. And if practically, I'm not the kind of person who needs that kind of space, but it is a fairly large space and not a lot of cars give you that large space. So I do appreciate that. What it does do though, is brings all the controls that would have been a far reach away on here, and it makes it all within reach easily right here. And that I appreciate. I think that's something worth pointing out about this design is that everything is easily within reach. So you've got your full climate system here. You can set the auto climate to 3 levels or 1 level, and it can all display on the screen. If you just want to watch it all, you can hit the climate button. And as we go up there, you can sort of see I've got dual zone temperature control, which is a really nice thing to have. That's probably another feature I would look for if I was designing my own car. Remember I said that there's certain things I would want. Dual zone climate control would be another thing that I would want in there. So you can just control everything you want. And what I really like about it is this new auto system. You can still leave the temperature at say 19 degrees. You can still, it decides on its own where it's gonna send fans and speed and everything else. But you can just slow it down a little bit, which is kind of nice. It doesn't blast you with air quite as much, which I kind of appreciate. So we'll turn that off for the video. And of course you have the tactile buttons for everything, including heating and cooling. Passenger can very easily figure out which side can warm up or cool down their side. So just a really nice clean design. Over here, again, some people find these push button gear shifts controversial, and let's be very honest. I used to think they were controversial as well. I still don't like them in the Ioniq. I don't think they're placed in the right order. I do kind of like them in these cars now, and I'll tell you why. It does give a cleaner look, park, reverse, neutral, drive. That's the only reason I don't like in the Ioniq. In this car, they're all in order where I expect them to be. And after about a day and a half of driving these cars, you get completely used to it. So auto reviewers don't like it because they're in a new car every day. They don't like to learn anything new. Regular drivers, you're going to like that. I think it's going to be just fine for you. Over here is the other nice thing that we have here. Not only drive modes, comfort, sport, and smart. Smart being essentially your eco mode. You can also switch the terrain modes and turn on snow, mud, or sand, which I really appreciate as well. You can just optimize not only the all-wheel drive system, but the traction control systems, hill descent control, various things for different terrains, and I think it's a good idea. Now, people always ask me, well, what happens if I'm driving down the road and I hit snow? Do I have to go dig for that snow mode? No. If you're driving down the road, you hit snow, you keep your hands on the wheel, and you keep control. The all-wheel drive system is always working at all times. What the snow mode does is optimize everything for snow, and that's where if you know you're heading out in snow, or if you hit some snow and you got a second to look down, you can hit that button and it works really well. I'm gonna open up the sunroof here because I'm getting warm in here. I didn't want to put the windows down, it's just been cleaned. All right, let's flip down over here. So again, auto start stop, the car can turn itself off at stoplights. A lot of you guys don't like that because you're familiar with it from other brands. It works very well in this brand. Auto hold is part of your automatic parking brake. Heated steering wheel and heated seats, rump roasters and digit defrosters, digits being fingers. You got heated steering wheel and heated seats. Now, the reason that heated steering wheel is really important is because nobody wears gloves anymore with touch screens in their car. And you get all these car reviewers again that sit there and say, oh, well, it's got these tactile buttons. I'm not sure how that's going to work with gloves on. Nobody wears gloves. You have a heated steering wheel. You want the heated steering wheel in your hand. Nobody wants to wear gloves. So that's what happens in a car. So you have heated steering wheel. Heated seats as well. Drive modes, really nice. There is a USB plug right here. You could drop your phone into this section right here if you wanted to. And of course, that does close up as well. So lots of places to put your things in. Again, because it's wireless Android Auto, Apple CarPlay, throw your phone in there. It sticks out a little bit. That's cool. And it works very well. So really nice design there. Over here, because you have the gear shift buttons here, you have paddle shifters. There's really no other reason to need them on here, except that on a traditional gear shift, you could easily downshift or upshift if you wanted to manually, and now you use paddle shifters for that. You will notice the smart cruise control. I want to talk about that really briefly. I love smart cruise control because if you're the kind of person like, I never really use cruise control, as soon as you have smart cruise control, you start to use cruise control. I don't know if that makes sense, but it just makes your highway drive much easier, much more comfortable. And then, of course, I almost always use it in traffic, which seems kind of counterintuitive, but using it in traffic makes your driving in traffic a lot easier because it can accelerate and brake on its own without exceeding whatever speed you set it for. And it can, in traffic, it works very well because it's constantly seeing vehicles. You can see in your dash if it's recognizing vehicles, so you know that it will stop or it will accelerate. So just a really smart feature to have here with that smart cruise control. And then the lane follow assist allows this vehicle to essentially steer for itself, keeping it centered in the lane. Now, of course, when I say steer for itself, that's not how they advertise it. That's not how we should talk about it. But it is what's going on. It's actively steering itself to keep centered in the lane. You do have to keep your hands on the wheel. There are plenty of YouTube videos showing people with hands off the wheel on this system for as much as 2 minutes or more. It's one of the best advanced driver assistance systems out there. That's pretty much agreed upon. Obviously, Tesla's the leader in all pilots. This system would be a very close second for a lot of car reviewers. So you'll see that in the comments when they start using that system. It works very, very well. It's something I highly recommend. Over here, simple Bluetooth controls, easy. And you got your lane keeping assist, so that's a little bit less advanced. Did they get rid of the sunglasses holder? Yes, they did. I don't know why. There is something going on in our systems up here that they have computers or something else. I don't know if it's for the forward-facing camera, which of course is your lane keep, lane follow, forward collision avoidance type system. I don't know if there's some computer systems in here, but they did get rid of that sunglasses holder up here. They add this Blue Link system, which is again that cell phone app and other systems. So it is something they are getting rid of in that section of the car. Of course, you do have space in the armrest. I never use that in my car, so for me, it's not something I think about, but obviously you get a hard case for your sunglasses, drop them in your armrest. That's probably what you're gonna have to get used to doing if that matters to you. One other thing I do appreciate on this car is there's three little buttons there. If you have three garage doors, and I don't have three garage doors, and this one, it can open all three of those garage doors. One thing I missed when test driving the 2022. Oh, okay, so that you're just saying you missed that. Yeah, so it does not have that sunglasses holder. But like I said, grab yourself a hard case for your sunglasses, make the dealer throw it in for you, and you can throw it in your armrest. So that is an option for you. That's what I do, and I don't find it's a problem. There is a nice little space here for the passenger to put their phone or some other items. It is a rubbery, grippy system, and I think it's underrated there. A lot of cars leave their passengers out on a road trip, and I think this is a good little spot there. So just a little bit nice details here. We mentioned that piping on the seat, it kind of is echoed in this system here that kind of wraps all the way around the passenger seat, wraps back around there. So it's just kind of a neat little system. And again, the driver's seat has it, again, a little bit less clean look because it has that little sharper edge, but really well-designed vehicle here. All right, so here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna take your questions. We're gonna see if we can go, let's set the bar really low. Let's see if we can go for 40 likes today. Gonna take your questions right now. We're gonna go rear seat space, trunk space, and I wanna show you some LED lighting features. And the rest of the video is guided by you guys. If you guys have something you wanna see, we'll do that. In front of the passenger seat is a perfect phone holder. Yeah, it really is. That's a really good point. It's fairly deep here, deeper than it looks on camera. And it is a rubber padded and it has a lip up the end. So yeah, that is an absolutely perfect place for a passenger's phone. Especially when you have this raised area that doesn't appear to have a lot of space. The next space would be a big space underneath there, which is a little harder to see. So that's a perfect spot. And again, that USB plug is just in down below to the left there. So good point there. All right, let's turn this vehicle to off for a second here. Jump out the door. I'm seeing some questions come in. I'm going to get to them in just a second here. And yeah, so we got 30 likes already. I think, what did I say? We're going for 40? 40 seems like a good number. A few less people on today, which is nice. Again, this is not as a popular car or not a brand new car like, well, it is 2022, but not a brand new design like we've had previous days. All right, so I should be able to answer most of your questions as best I can. If I miss something, feel free to ask it again. Just give me a little bit of time to answer the first time, though. All right, yesterday you talked about the shipping process. Can you tell us more about that? I missed it live yesterday. I was unable to ask. Best thing to do is go back and watch. Basically, some of these cars have to be ordered. If they're not in production, so something like a Kia Carnival wasn't in production, you wouldn't have a VIN number, and to be very honest, your dealer would have no real clue of when it's going to be done. They can give you guesstimates, they can give you educated guesstimates, but anybody tells you it's going to be 6 months or 8 months for that particular car does not really know how long it's going to be until it's ordered. So a good dealer will be honest with you the whole way. That's the same thing with this. These are a little bit tougher to find sometimes, but they'll be honest with you, so we can talk about that a little bit later. Are there cars with auto dimming side rear mirrors? People are driving with high beams at night and it's killing my eyes on long journeys. Off the top of my head, the Kia Stinger does have those. I'm sure others do in these lineups. I can't remember. The Stinger just jumped to my head because it's one of the ones I remember driving at night with it. But I'm not sure. Does the Santa Fe have the same chassis as the Kia Sorento? Good question. Essentially, it's so we don't call them chassis anymore. We call them platforms. Things like wiring harnesses are often shared. Much of the structure, the Santa Cruz, the Tucson, and the future Kia Sportage also share a general platform. A lot of these platforms can be modified to be lengthened, shortened, widened, that kind of thing. But yes, the Santa Fe and the Sorento would be sharing a platform. So that's correct. And when will you guys be getting the 2022 Hyundai Santa Fe luxury plug-in hybrid? And what's the lead time on these vehicles? Lead time, I'm not sure. When will we get one? I'm not also sure right now. The one that I do know that's coming is the Sorento PHEV should be here by the end of this month. So again, same platform, same powertrain is going to be coming on this. Hyundai, I don't have an exact date on when theirs is coming, but Kia PHEV Sorento will be here at the end of the month. Well, it's due to be in the city by the end of the month, so hopefully it shows up on time. We'll get on video by then. If you take the auto climate control off, can you direct the air where you want to go? Yes, absolutely. So the auto climate control sends the air where you want it to, but if you want to set it in a specific spot, up, lower, down, you can always take control of that. Great question there. Auto climate control assists you, but anytime you want to make it a manual system and put it wherever you want, put the speed wherever you want, temperature whatever you want, you can do that as well. Does it have tactile indicators on the shift so you can get used to it and press it without looking at it? Yeah, so the buttons are really, they're push down buttons. And that's a really good question. I know in an automatic transmission, we all just put it in gear and we can feel where it is. This is the same thing. You put your hand down, you can feel where it is. Like I said, it's auto reviewers seem to hate it. And I think anybody who drives this car for more than a day and a half can do it without even looking. So it's very common. You can see in the dash what gear you're in. It's not hard. It's something I thought I wouldn't like. And I'm very careful to watch my prejudices. When I think, oh, I'm not gonna like that, I find myself evaluating that all the time, realizing, you know what, it's not a big deal. So I actually kind of like it. It cleans up the dash. It doesn't bother me at all. what is going on? So yeah, lead time. Somebody asked that twice. Lead time for the PHEVs. I'll have to look into that. I haven't asked them lately. When do I expect the 2023 Sportage? Probably spring, March-ish. But again, the whole auto industry is crazy right now. Some things are getting delayed. So because I haven't heard yet, I'll assume everything's normal and we'll call it March-ish. But we'll see what goes on. All right, let's dig back into this vehicle really quickly. We're gonna go rear seat space, we're gonna go trunk space. I wanna show you the LED lighting as well, front and rear. You get LED lighting in the rear here. One thing I didn't point out was the LED lighting on the inside of the vehicle. I'll try to do that right now. Where are we? Oh, there we go. They are nice. Whoops, let me just flip around here. The lights in this car are nice white LED, and that still has shipping plastic on it. Gotta get that out. But nice white LED, and that is kind of a nice thing for a richer looking interior. One thing I really like when you're sitting in here, you do have tinted windows, of course, but you also have these blinds that come up. The camera kind of adapts, but they do give you quite a bit of extra shade. You can see no shade, no window, right? You know, tinted window. So they really do give you a lot of shade. And one thing I like on the Tucson, all of our other cars, it comes in back and hooks on the opposite side. This one hooks on the front side. It's much easier to be able to pull this out, pull it towards me here, and click it into there with one hand. So I don't know if you saw that, that's just me not filming well. Click it into there with one hand. It's much easier to do it the way it's sitting on this car than it is on many of our other cars where you have to hook it on the backside. So kudos to Hyundai for figuring or making that change there. Back here, again, very good legroom. I'm sitting behind myself. I could probably move the driver's seat forward a little bit, but a lot of knee room in here. Interestingly, the Tucson and this are probably similar legroom. So it feels very similar. This is a Tucson alternative, very much so. So if you drive one, you should drive the other. One thing that's nice about this is the recline on the seats go way back. Are the rear seats better in this car than the Tucson? I don't know. They might be a little bit larger. Might be. It's hard to say. Both are very good, but they're different cars. So this might be a little larger seats. Legroom, obviously, very similar between the two. And let's flip down right around here. Pocket just on the passenger side. Plastic back seats. If you've got kids, that just wipes down with a clean cloth. And maybe a damp cloth, pocket there, vents here, two USB ports there, kind of everything you want, nothing you don't need. And of course, armrest in the center with cup holders and bottle holders in the side there. So let's jump out of here, show you the trunk space. So just a kind of well thought out car. A lot of features that I really like are in this vehicle. Trunk space here is not a power trunk. Some people always ask that. This one doesn't have that. That doesn't bother me at all, although some of you seem to like that. You can get a power-assisted tailgate, but you would have to move up a trim level. So the Tucson, if you look at it, has more trunk space than this, by liters, by cubic feet, whatever you want to measure as. I'm not sure that that's true overall. I think what happens is they don't include this underfloor storage, which is massive. I don't think they include that in the Santa Fe numbers the same way they do in the, like the Tucson has a lowering floor. So I think this one is probably bigger if you include the underfloor storage, but no question the Tucson wins a little bit because it has a little bit lower floor. So it's kind of interesting that a smaller SUV has the bigger trunk, but like I said, I'm not convinced that that's fully true. Put Teddy Bear in here, you can see our Santa Fe video, or our, Tucson videos to compare it. You can fit two teddy bears in here. Very large trunk, very comfortable for teddy bear, and good length. Sometimes he's kind of squished up, or good width, I guess I should say. Sometimes he's squished up, so he's pretty good. So the reason I use our teddy bear is just to compare between vehicles. You can see most videos that I do trunk comparisons, I throw teddy bear back here. One of the extra features that they have here is just this push button to release the rear seats. So because those seats are hard to reach, little push button drops them down. You can see the 12-volt port there as well. Kind of a nice feature. All right, closing this down. Taking a quick peek, that slamming, clacking noise was just because this plate frame isn't on as tight as it needs to be right now, so don't worry about that. All right, finally, let's take a look at the lighting, because I like it. I think it's done well on this car, and I think sometimes manufacturers do funny things, and they don't make cars look good, and yes, I'm talking about you, Toyota, and I think Hyundai does a really good job here. So, daytime running lights, let's see if we can go and see the non-reflective side over here. We've got a lot of nice reflection on these paint. So daytime running lights is kind of cool. This is a separate light than that, and these are separate lights, but they all look at night, like, or even in the daytime, kind of like a single piece in there. These would normally be off during the day, but they are your headlights, and they are nice bright LED headlights. And you can see the nice sharp cutoff, nice bright lights. And that pays dividends over here, where you can see in the daylight, it doesn't always show, and my camera doesn't always show. To me, it looks yellow through the camera, looks very white in person, but nice daylight style color, so when you're driving at night, you can identify things. I really give them credit for that. And because this is the preferred trend package, that extra package that adds on, you get these LED rear lights as well, and they just look sharp in person. They don't film the same way, and they kind of look like they're faded here. That's not the way they look in real life, but they are a nice, sharp looking light, just a real precision to it. Gives the car some width, just looks really good in person, and I think you got to give them credit for throwing those LED lights on this trim line. It looks really sharp. All right, so we got about 40 people on still. We're about half an hour in. I'm looking for 40 likes still. So there's four of you holding out on me. I'm hoping that I can earn your like. All I do is spend a half an hour with you, and the only thing I ask in return is you spend that split second hitting that like button. Really appreciate that. Helps us, and it also helps people that are maybe looking at this car to know that this is a video worth watching. So. And maybe it's not a video worth watching, and I accept that not everybody's going to have that opinion. Real spin-out tire, inside or under? It is under, I believe. Should we try to take a look at it? Sure, we can do that. Oh, I don't usually lay on the floor. Let's see how we can do it. Anybody wants to see underneath? Can we do it? Oh, there we go. There it is. So it is a donut-style spare, so it's full diameter but less width. And it's very easy to drop down. You have a little tire iron inside here. You spin it on the inside, and it drops down. Very clean process, very easy to do. But yeah, full diameter, but smaller width tire. So that's a good question there. I don't usually show that, so that's good. What's the difference between the Santa Fe for 21 and 22? Biggest difference, really, I will show you. That's a good question. Let me just flip the camera around here. Ooh, look at that. I'm glowing. Okay. Let me just bear with me for a second. I'll show you on the computer the biggest difference. It's easier to show you. Ooh, where do we go? All right, biggest difference is right here. Flip around here. Is the Urban Edition. That is a new model for 2022. I have not seen that vehicle here. Sounds interesting. It's got the turbo engine, just nice, unique wheels. It sounds pretty cool. We'll talk about that when it comes more, but that really is the big difference. I don't think there's any real changes. I don't know if the PHEV was out last year or hybrids, so those would be differences as well this year. You're gonna see them in volume, or at least potential, right? So that's really the difference. Just a sharp overall car. Like I said, it's the newest platform for these vehicles. The Sorento shares it, so just a really good platform. Okay, going to look at one of these today. Same set, red and trend, but with two-tone leather. Now is the two-tone. So this is not two-tone leather. Sportage we talked about. All right, I think that's all the questions I have. Oh, somebody just asked. Hold on, I'm trying to make sense of something. But how is the two-tone? Okay, so you know what? I have not seen this trim line in the two-tone. So you're asking me how's the two-tone leather on this car? I haven't seen it on this car, so I can't give you an accurate thing. I have seen the two-tone leather on other cars, and I usually quite like it. Two-tone leather is one of those things where you like it or you don't. We just had the Kia Carnival show up here today in Martian Brown. So that's a brown and black leather mix. I like it. I like it a lot. I'm the kind of guy who likes something that's a little bit different. It's not going to be for everybody. So if you're a two-tone leather person, I think you'll be satisfied with that. All right, I think we've caught up to all the questions here. Is there something that I've missed? I don't think there's anything that I've missed in there. We had a little bit few less people on. We got about 46 people on today, so that'll be a 300 people on or something like that by the time this video is done. I think we covered most of the questions. Like I said, tomorrow, Kia Carnival SX. In the future, Urban Edition of this. PHEV and hybrid versions of this. Lots going on. I'm just going to get some notifications there. So lots going on. If you've never seen our channel, we're not a review channel. We're actually a dealership group. So I'm not the kind of person who has a vehicle for just 1 week or just makes one video and then it's gone. If you want to see this vehicle again, you can suggest it. You can request it. You can ask questions about it. We'll pull it back in here. We pull vehicles back in over and over and over again. So if you're interested in these vehicles, Kia or Hyundai vehicles, or specifically this one, hit the subscribe button. Let me know what you want to see. Let me know what you like about this video and about the vehicle. And we'll fill the comments and we'll do our best to keep growing for you and doing our best. I want to thank everyone for joining us and we'll see it. Where am I in Canada? That's a really good question. We're based in Brantford, Ontario. We have two dealers in Brantford, Hyundai and Kia dealer, and we have a Hyundai dealer in Owen Sound as well. So if you're looking to buy in Ontario, we can be your local dealer. We can help you out. We can ship your car to you. We can flatbed it to you so it's not even driven. We can work with you. So you can reach out to me after this video. There'll be a link in the description, or there's a link in the description to most of our other videos. You can find a way to reach me there, and we'll connect you up. Thanks, everyone, for watching. Have a great day. We'll see you tomorrow.